So this one is how to model a lightning strike. We're going to try and make an animation of a lightning strike that looks realistic. And I'm not claiming that it is a realistic model of lightning. Yeah, this is kind of secretly a demonstration of an algorithm in computer science called breadth first search, which we'll be showing as like a maze solving algorithm. So what we have is a frontier of exploration, bits of lightning, and one of them hits the ground first, and that the path that that one followed ends up being the shape of the lightning strike. So you have like a frontier of exploration, and then as soon as you find it, that one gets reinforced and that becomes a lightning strike. And this is taking place inside a randomly generated labyrinth. So maybe the walls inside this maze would correspond to fluctuations in the air, like variations in the resistance, or how charges can pass through the air. And maybe if air was perfectly homogeneous, it would just be lightning would always be a straight line, I don't know.
It's really good looking, this one, isn't it? Were you pleased with how it turned out once you'd made it? Did you think, wow, that looks awesome?
Yeah, I think it was quite like satisfying, I think. There's a kind of game at the beginning where you're like, well, which one's going to win? And, you know, in some of these, you've got two or three competing parts. And yeah, is this one going to win? Is this going to win? And then that one wins in the end. And then you have the satisfying bolt of lightning at the end.
Your cat seems really into it.
Yeah, helps me out with all of these animations. This is done in Mathematica. So the first stage is generating the random maze. Then there's solving the maze. And then there's generating the animation from the solution. So here we are in Mathematica. This is code to randomly generate a maze, which we're visualizing here. So maybe you can see if I run this every time, I'm going to get a random configuration of walls in the maze.
How do you know the maze is always going to be solvable?
What I would do is just generate it again and again until it is solvable. Since it's random, basically it turns out it'd be quite unlucky if it's not solvable, but I could be unlucky, and then the output of the breadth first search will be, there is no solution to this maze, and I'll say, okay, let's generate another random one. The way this works is that we're going to be working on a square grid. Here are all the points that might be connected by lines of a square, and then each of these potential lines here will either be free or there will be a wall of the maze. You know, there's one probability for each of these being joined, yeah. And then there's a different probability for the horizontal ones. And I did that just because I wanted to make it more likely to be solvable. So these have a different probability Q, say, of being joined, and then I just set it so that, you know, I'd set it so that Q was less likely than P.
There are more vertical lines than horizontal lines.
Yeah, there should be, but there might not be. So then there is the step to solve the maze. You know, that's this code here. It's relatively easy to just sort of show how it works, I think. So say we have some maze, and what we're asking is, we're going to start at a point at the top, right? Our goal is to get down to the bottom. So, you know, lightning is somewhere in the cloud, and then we just need to get anywhere on the ground. We've got various walls that are joined. This might be enough to get the idea. You know, theoretically, we could just solve this by trying all possible paths to the bottom, but we could be more efficient than that. And the idea is that we're just going to take it one step at a time. We know that we're starting in this cell, so we can get there in zero steps. Now we can get to this one in one step, and get to this cell in two steps. We can get to this cell in three steps, and to this cell in four steps. Now we've got a branching point. And this might be where you would be worried that, okay, now our code is going to go off and be intractable. But really, let's just take it one step at a time and just record how far we can get. This cell we can get to in five steps, and we can also get to this one in five steps. Now, where can we get to in six steps? We can get here, we can get here, or we can get here. How far can we get in seven steps? You know, there's a box up here we can get to. Here we could go right or down. here we could go down, you know, and eventually we're going to have some kind of path that goes something like this. Now that we've got to the bottom, what that's told us is there's a path to the bottom that only takes 10 steps. So let's not bother looking at all the 11 steps ones because we know how to get there in 10. All we need is the shortest path. It's called breadth first search.
Breadth first search.
Yeah, breadth first, and that's as opposed to depth first.
What happens in your code if there's a tie?
Yeah, that's a good question. In that case, it will just be down to basically random or the way that I implemented the code. You know, maybe I looked at paths to the left before I looked paths down or to the right. And so I'll just pick a tie. So yeah, it's ambiguous. Yeah.
Okay.
So here, you know, before we generated one and it looks like we were lucky and there is a path that goes down. So yeah, so this was the original maze, and now this is solving the maze and just visualizing the path, which is maybe a bit hard to see because it doesn't correspond with that. But you know, maybe I could quickly draw them on top of each other. Let's make the path red. We solved this original maze, and this ended up being the shortest path, or one of the shortest paths.
So Matthew, the animation that you ended up publishing is just an arbitrary one that the code spat out randomly that you liked the look of.
Yeah, I did a couple on a smaller maze and a couple in a bigger maze, and I ran a few, and those ones seemed like interesting ones where there was some kind of race going on in the lightning. And yeah, they just ones that looked nice, I thought. So we could look at the one that we happened to randomly generate there. The third step in the code is just sort of drawing the picture in a nice way. So we'll be using all the numbers that we had to color the frontier as time progresses. So, you know, for example, the sixes were kind of interesting because we had the frontier at one point will look like this. We'll have all the sixes. And I will color them so that this bottom six will be brighter than this top six, because in some sense it's more promising.
It's right? Winning.
It's winning in some way. Even though it lost in the end, I guess, because this six looked lower and was winning, but ends up losing because there's a better path starting going along from that six.
Yeah.
So that's what the animation here does. So you start just creating.
So you're coloring equal numbers, basically.
Yeah, that's right. And I think there's a bit of fuzziness as well. So I'm maybe drawing here. I'm drawing all the, well, I could find out all the 16s. But the 15s are still fading out of existence at that point. And this is the most promising 16, which maybe looks like a dead end, actually.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so then this actually becomes more promising. And this one's, you know, coming into existence.
This is so much fun. I feel like you could just sit there like betting on it, or like you're just sort of in your mind, you're running a little, oh, is it going to win? Which one's going to win? I still don't know. Oh, that one down the middle. No, yes, no, yes.
You got it. And then there's that. Of course, that was a solution, right?
This is so satisfying to watch these. I could watch these all day.
So, and then we can change things. Like we could make the maze bigger or smaller. Bigger or smaller? Should we try?
Why not? I got nowhere to be.
We could make it not square as well, I suppose. Do you want a wide and thin? Or tall and...
I think tall.
Yeah.
Tall is more fun, surely.
Let's make it the same, but twice as tall.
Okay.
So now we have...
So quick, just a couple of keystrokes.
Yeah, but let's see if we can solve it as quickly. No. So I think this means that it was an unsolvable maze. My code creates this nice red box if it's unsolvable. So let's try again. So we would just regenerate. This is a new maze. Can you tell? Is it solvable?
I can't tell.
I think there is a path down here. I think.
See, are you going to get the red box of doom?
No.
No, there's a path.
A straight path down. And that's what it looks like in the context of the original maze.
And will it animate as well?
Should they? Okay. Here we go. Oh, we've got two kind of parallel... So it looks like there were two that were very close, and we ended up picking this one.
Yeah, so there were two that were There were two winners, but they chose them. That is fun. That is seriously fun. But just to be clear, you're not a meteorologist and you're not claiming this is how real lightning works. It just looks like lightning.
Yeah, this is not an accurate model of lightning. When I posted this animation, it did get a lot of attention from meteorologists, and it sort of got retweeted around the world of American weather presenters. So I'm worried that I've convinced them that this is how lightning works, but...
This episode's been supported by KiwiCo. Now, in the past, you've seen me making all sorts of cool stuff. This time, I've shared the love and had KiwiCo send a crate to my nephew, Sebastian. You can see his co-pilot here is Chelsea. Together, they're putting together a domino machine. This crate's targeted at ages 9+, perfect for 10-year-old Seb, but there's a whole range of crates available on the site for people of all ages. Everything you need is home-delivered already in the box. It's so enriching to expose young minds to science and engineering and technologies in ways like this. But you don't have to take my word for it. Just look here at Sebastian. Whether it's for yourself or maybe as a gift, check out KiwiCo. And there's 50% off the first month of your subscription by going to kiwico.com/numberphile. There on the screen, kiwico.com/numberphile. And there is one very happy creator and his domino laying machine. Even Sebastian's little brother got some value from this one.
Let's say, and I'm here, right? I can't go left or right here, I can't go left or right here, I can't go left or right here. And I'm spending a lot of time going to this one, adding it to the queue, to this one, and then going down here. I'm taking 1, 2, 3, 4 steps, when really one step would have sufficed.
Okay.
Where are you going? I hope your eyes are closed.
Okay, and they are. They definitely are.
Start with a draw.
Okay.
Right over there.
There, there's one.
Okay, so we have Edward Sabine, referee reports by J.B. Airy on some of his papers. Let's choose the lunar tide one and the magnetism one.